evening, everyone. Thanks for coming. We are a very small practice, as Suzanne has mentioned, and we practice down in Tyrol, north of Wollongong. Our practice was founded nearly 10 years ago now, coming up to our 10-year anniversary, which happened after we had just spent a few months in living in Europe. I'm from Germany originally, so we went there and tried to work out if there's any chance of us working overseas. Wasn't much work going on, but great fun to be had. But at some point we had to come back, and we had also been working in Sydney for a number of years before that and decided not to return for various reasons. And so we moved to the south coast of New South Wales and started our practice from a small little beach shack at Lake Conjola. A great mentor of ours, which we will introduce later, he once told us that you should always start things as you wish to continue and finish them. So we decided to be quite deliberate in the sort of projects we take on. There wasn't much work down there anyway, so we were quite selective in to do some work in Sydney and in the surrounding region. So there wasn't that much to do. We had plenty of time to fish in between, as you can see. So that's why the staple food at the time was flathead from the lake. That was all great fun, but for me that was a little bit too isolated, so I wanted to move back to the city, towards the city at least. And so we drew a map together where I said, look, I really would like to be within an hour of Sydney so that I can go to the galleries and have a little bit of fun. And Brent said, well, I want to be within 5 minutes of the beach so I can go and surf. So we marked that out. Palm Beach wasn't our thing, and so we ended up in the Illawarra, which both of us had never been to, lived at, or really visited even. I moved into the house unseen. I turned up with the boxes and Brent had just happened to rent it. But that turned out to be a great move. So our second office was a bedroom in that house. It had a great view. It was leaking all over the computers. It wasn't so great. But we loved it there, and so we decided to make that a little bit more permanent, and we built our own studio in the backyard. See there. It was a great learning experience for us in building ourselves and trying to work out how to put it together exactly. And from there, many things have followed on since then. We still work from the same space. We had to unfortunately move it to another location, or fortunately we say now, because our landlord, as soon as it was nearly finished, decided to put the rent up, which he given us assurances he would not, because he thought we couldn't leave. But we had considered that, and we built it in a way that it could be paralyzed, taken apart. It took us 2 weeks to put it back together at the new location, and it was all fine. He was rather shocked when the team of footy players turned up and just took it away. Literally a team of footy players. So this is us. We're still working from the same space. It's in a similar location, up near the escarpment in the rainforest, just a suburb further south. So this is us. It's a team of individuals, really. It's turned into, Brent and I might have founded the practice, but it's really turned into a collaboration of many people. There's a core team, which is us and Daniel from this university, who were lucky enough to convince to move down south to work for us. On the right, there is legend Tom, who is a graduate architect who, at the same time, has traveled a lot. He's a permaculture expert and generally just a good one all around. And then there's been various other people involved over time, amongst others Eve Marie on the left there is a carpenter who we've employed to help us build things because we like to get our hands dirty as we'll sort of go through. What inspires us? There are many things. So we try to represent them in this image. There is landscape and the patterns that nature creates that we seek out, photograph, and make part of each building in some way or another. We are very interested in materials and in how qualities in each material. We try to explore that as much as possible. So the second one is a gold leaf wall in one of the Bauhaus buildings in Germany. We are very interested in different construction methods. There's the side of an old Nordic fishing boat where the planks were just hand sewn together. And we also, I think there's a theme in our project where we explore light and shadow and the spaces that creates. And then fifth, not shown because we get to that later, is the people that inspire us, because we, the people we work and the clients we work for. We think detail is very, very important. It's really critical to any architectural quality. And there's many architects we admire in how they're able to carefully join different materials together to create something new. There's Zumthor's chapel, Buddha Glass Chapel, where the lead and the water meet to create something else when it rains through a penetration ceiling. There's Utzon's really simple glazing detail, and then Frank Lloyd Wright's cladding Taliesin. This is sort of mapping out the projects we've completed over the last 10 years. Working in a regional area south of Sydney, really, we do travel a lot, which is, there's good and bad to it, but I think the thing we love about it is that we get to work across different landscapes and different climatic conditions and get to explore something about those different places each time. There's a sort of a selection of projects. They cover all scales. They range from really small buildings. There's a little, I think it's about 6 square meters, little bedroom for a friend's son on the veranda, to larger houses. There's also our studio, and from that, from the modular building that we've developed there, we've then taken this further to develop a construction system, so where we explore modular small buildings. We've got a second company that builds those, like the one on the top there on the right, but that's a whole different talk again, so we're dabbling in construction at the same time. We always also seem to have one of our own projects happening. They obviously never finish because we're architects. We're building on the office space. It's about 8 years now we're building the office building. There's always things that have to be redone or changed. We're just building a little meeting room, and there's another amenities block called Dunny. So always something to do, and there's a workshop under the house, and we all get involved, which is a great fun. And it teaches us more about how buildings are put together. It's really just a different scale of making a model. So allowing yourself to build a small building allows you to explore the things you could explore in the model in much more detail. All right, so the talk, I have to slow down a little bit, maybe. I don't know how we're going for time. We sort of spoke about, we wanted to speak about, not just show you the pretty pictures, as Sören was mentioning, but to show you our architectural process, because we think process is absolutely critical in architecture. It informs the end result of the building. It allows us to get to know a client, allows the client to take some ownership of the final result in the building by being involved in this process all along. So we want to talk to you about how we do this, and we structured it sort of loosely on the architectural phases of architectural services. We've decided to use three of our projects that are all residential of nature and somewhat comparable to illustrate how they can be different, but the process stays essentially the same. We can confuse you a little bit while we put little icons on the bottom so you know what we're talking about. So the first one is a house just near us in Thrall. We started in 2011, this project, so that has been in our office for quite some time. It was for a single person who at the time came to us and decided though that he wanted to build something that is future-proof for his plans. So it's a four-bedroom house, one office, on an average suburban block. It's actually quite large because of the requirements he had. We call this carbon house, which you'll see why that is. The second one is a project in Robertson in Southern Highlands. More remote, a large side, smaller footprint for a couple from Sydney who use it as the holiday house, but they actually come down pretty much every weekend. We just finished it, or nearly I should say, called Kambiarawa, and the third one is called the Blade House, not far from us as well, on a fairly small block with a large brief that included a granny flat at the same time as well.
Interesting.
Oh, what happened now?
Connection.
Oh.
That's only half. Just start it again. So, the first stage of any project, starts with a whole lot of research. So every project always starts with a phone call from the client. We introduce ourselves, they tell us a little bit about what they want to do, but then the first thing we do before we go and look at a site is really to do a little bit of research on what it is that, all the overlays that, from a constraints perspective, that apply to the site. So that's council things, it's mapping, terrain mapping, bushfire, whatever it might be, so we can come to the first site as it is prepared as possible and we understand a little bit about the place that we're talking about. Then we have, so this is the first project, first site visit, so this one, small cottage on the site which she wanted to demolish, it was nearly falling apart, partly due to his dog, who was chewing on everything in the house, the cladding, the table, the door, you name it, it had chew marks on it. So he told us there that he was single, but he really wanted to build a family home because he was obviously really hoping for that family. So he thought he'd build the home first and the family would come, which is exactly what has happened, actually. So that was really interesting. When we came to the site, to the things that stood out, we climbed on the roof to have a look what potential there might be. So the thing that most kept us occupied there was really the presence of this carpman. So we lived just under there in the shadows, basically. And on his side, he had this sweeping view of this beautiful ridge and the sandstone outcrops across it. And it was also really close to the ocean and the cliffs and the erosion that's happening, so it might wash away eventually. So once we visited someone and met them for the first time, we then go back and we try to consolidate our impressions and keep some track of what we found there. So we often do sketches on the side of the things that interest us. We do some research, in this case, on the geology of the area on this carpment. Its location, its development over time, and the things that interested us about it, for example, the layers of different strata of rock and coal, in our case, same as Newcastle, and how they become apparent even at the nearby beach and the cliff face. We then also have a look at climate and weather patterns for each site. In this case, it became apparent that it's quite exposed to the southerly winds in winter, really cold, so we need protection from that side. It got battered by the storms that come through. And that in summer, because it had a lot of sun there, we really need to dress in with the easterly breezes, so if you look at the windrows and things like that. And then we try to put that all together into a site analysis drawing that basically keeps reminding us what are the things that we need to consider on our design. And summarizes that for the client as well. We share all this with the client as we go. Second project, quite different, remote site, not in town in Robertson, on this little shelf sitting above Kangaroo Valley, with an amazing view to the southeast and rainforest wall, remnant rainforest at the back. So we met them on site, and when we have remote sites like this, it's really hard to understand them in a single site visit, so we try to extend that time. We usually camp on those sites, stay overnight to work out what happens in the morning, what happens when the sun comes, what are the things we need to think of. And in this case, it was, for example, that everything was dripping wet. It was summer, but everything was completely wet in the morning because the rainforest just, there's so much humidity in the air. And Robertson has the highest rainfall in New South Wales, I think, as well. So those are all things you only learn if you spend some time on the site, I believe. We do sketches. In this case, they were about the view the landscape, the undulations across the site, how fences moved across, and the contours that interested us. There's a section, so the site is sitting on this little shelf here. This is Kangaroo Valley, basically. There's the escarpment where we live at the front, and it was overlooking all this on a clear day, you could see the ocean. But the sun came pretty much from the back, so that was an interesting challenge. Site analysis, same as before. In this case, it takes into account water courses and things like that. The biggest picture as well, since it's a larger site. Third project, little suburban block, fairly steep. It's smaller than it looks here because that's a panorama picture. It has a similar issue actually, in that the view to the ocean is to the southeast, and then to the north it's surrounded by neighboring buildings. This is a family of four who just wanted a home built. They lived across the road, they left the neighborhood, they left the community, and they just wanted to stay there, so they bought that block of land. In that case, we looked into the history of the area, and it was a timber town, basically, or that string of towns north of Wollongong. They all were built initially because they were cutting down the Australian Red Cedars from the escarpment. It's sort of grown back a little bit since then, and some coal mining, obviously. There was some urban sort of constraints on overlooking views, issues, privacy, and things like that, and a geotag report, which shall become important later. Site analysis in this case, talking about neighbours and the impact that has, that we have on the neighbours. Good hand to you.
So we think it's important to take a break every now and again. For most people, again, as Suanne said, most people get exposure to architecture these days, and it's a good thing in some ways through these shiny, finished, successful projects that they see on Instagram and various other places. We really try in that first phase to get behind the image from people. They always bring us images. We always ask them why. They're usually out of context. They're usually out of budget. We always try, and when we get to the point where we understand what they start talking about experiences, not about pictures and about objects, then we feel like we can begin the design process. So we really love camping. Everything we need for life fits in the car, and once the stuff is gone, then we can actually spend a lot of time living life, which is fantastic. And luckily we like it. That's the cat on the machinery shed floor on another site visit after the client's tent completely failed during the night. So that project was quite uncomfortable for site visits. It's not always as great as it sounds. So I'm just going to walk through the next stage, which is going to overlay the first ones. We really try to share this entire process with our clients. We found in the beginning that just presenting them with a shiny answer to their problems often resulted in a bit of shock. It was often too far away from where they'd started from. And so we've really tried since very early in the practice to share the journey quite openly with them. So this escarpment house project, Katharina spoke about the layering of the escarpment. We did make a three-dimensional model of the whole escarpment for some reason. The coal seams are exposed, the layers of time in that escarpment are visible, and that landscape wall, the weather maker, is really, you know, what we're about. The southeasterly hits that escarpment, of course, and dumps a lot of rain, which is where the timber comes from. So the cedar history and the timber and the coal and the layers was really, you know, we've just moved to the area and we were quite inspired by those kind of underlying geological conditions. Once we've done the research and we've got the piles of paper of thoughts, initial discussions, we really then try to share with our clients the key findings in almost icons, in very simple sketches. So I won't go through all of them, but in this one, here's the horizontality, the shifting ground planes, which you see in the rock shelves at different tidal times around, just next to the house. The client was a photographer. He was quite a good photographer as a hobbyist, and so he understood we're trying to use the language and demystify the language so that we're using the language that they can relate to as soon as possible. Some concept design plans. He's quite a measured client. He's quite a considered person, and we, in response, was quite an orderly plan, a structural layout that was quite clear, but that grid augments, it stretches, and it closes up depending on the functionality of the rooms. The living spaces are bigger, and it also erodes into the landscape, which is something that you see heading out this direction, which is what's happening just next door to it. In that way, there it constantly we use the building design process as a way to make visible some of these other forces that are obviously there. Some sections here's the. It's a very clear southerly. You know, we're gonna protect ourselves from the south here and put a roof over and grab that north light. This is the project in Robertson. We sort of talk in the office a lot about drawing as being important. That when you make a drawing, it is a finished drawing. It's a drawing which. At any point in time, you have to consider that is the final drawing, because there's no final drawing until the building's complete anyway. So this idea that you might start a drawing and then not finish it is a bit, we want people to finish them, we want ourselves to finish them so that we can then talk to the client about these various ideas. And so obviously here, this was looking into the relationship between this sort of dual-sided site, the duality of the Yarrawa Brush rain, original rainforest, and then the open pasture that looked out onto the view. How do you protect in a windswept environment like that? So models help a lot in that sort of shared discussion within us, within the office as well. We, as Kat mentioned, we've got a workshop, we've got, you know, there's no point at which any of us sort of feel like we can't go and make a model if we need to. In this case, it was 1 to 500, I think, something really small. We spent all this time making a site model and all looking at it and all wondering what to do. Realising that then the contours were different to what the rainforest shape of that form was making, so that was quite a different thing with the denuded from all of its rainforest. And then that was all we used them. We made this model and that was put away. Again, the icons we were interested in, I won't go into too much. You'll see in it, we were interested in there was a building platform, an amphitheatre, and we're interested in surrounding that so that we could provide, not building on in the middle of that platform, just off the edges of it, so that we could contain a landscape. We'll see that again soon. We kind of wonder why architecture in Australia isn't as unique as our landscape, our flora, fauna, and the platypus, the kangaroo, the koala. All these animals are so incredibly unique. They're structurally inventive, they're adaptive, they're responsive to that sort of underlying truth of the environment. Very lean, and we sort of seem to have all these buildings that, you know, in that way of thinking, they're kind of a bit like building cows everywhere. So I think you shouldn't build cows, you should really try. Oh, here's the kangaroo, the wombat, and the eagles up on that site, which are all present on those places. The third one is the blade house. This client actually had been trying to nut us out for a long time themselves. They came to us with a model. So actually concept design started with us testing their model and seeing whether that would actually work. We did that with them. We did that in the same room, the same table, the same bit of paper, no mysterious kind of going away and coming back with an answer. We sat there and we asked them, what couldn't they solve? Why couldn't they solve it? And in the end, this one was for us to fit the volume of house, which is still a two-story house, but it's a small house by traditional standards. It's got the view to the light to the north, the view to the southeast. It slopes away, so if we put the volume stretched east-west, then we would shade the rest of the block. We had huge setbacks as a corner block, so it ended up going to the running north-south, but then cracking the whole west facade, so we get blades running down that side. The concept design sketches. So, I think what is delightful about being an architect, what I really enjoy about my job, is that you can experience this kind of magic where you. Working through the research, working with the client, working through the whole process, you can be in a position where you imagine yourself within a space. And then later on down the track, you can stand in that space that was once inside you. So it's a very satisfying process, and by drawing people in there, we find that invites the clients to join into the discussion. In one drawing, we drew a client reading a book, and they told us later that they decided to go ahead because they'd really been able to see themselves on that veranda playing that guitar, just like in the drawing. And anyway, we hadn't drawn a guitar, but that was fantastic. It's the fuzziness, you know, it has to allow them enough space to come in. And it's again that this concept design phase is all about inviting them to take part and see themselves in there. And it's not finished yet. It's going over the same thing over and over again. I think that's the other thing about our process, is that we really work these things, and we do need time out. It's bad for your bodies. Katharina takes off every lunchtime, goes swimming. The boys detune my guitars at any... They call them tune, but I can't play them, so they kind of messed with that. But I think it's really important as architects to take regular breaks and look after the kind of person that you are. Because it, you know, after a while, it starts to really hurt, and that's just not sustainable. Design development. We did have a computer model for this one earlier, but usually this is where we start to test out some more things. We test out density. This one's, you can see some layering tests in here. That's the density of the layering and the framing of the landscape that we were working with. There's a bit of an idea here of the earth being drawn up around, so it feels a bit more underground, semi-underground, kind of eroded underneath there. This one's the design development for Camp Yarra, which, you know, does result in a reasonably finished set of drawings, but to the client. But we do continually explain to them that this is not the end. This is, and I think this design development phase is one that gets in the pace of a lot of work. A lot of people question whether this phase is kind of necessary. Can we just go straight? Can we just lodge this as a DA? But to our way of thinking, it's one more opportunity which we're constantly taking to improve what is going to be the final outcome. It's sharpening the saw, really, this whole process. This is the view studies, some more sketches. And then finally, and in fact, the Blade House, we really had problems turning the corner from one facade to the next. There were some massing issues. We wanted this corner on the right here to dissolve somewhat. And so we spent a lot of time trying to draw, making the computer model, but without too much success, until finally we just sat down and started to make some parts of this as a model. And that really did help us. And I think in most projects, there's a seminal point within that process where you taste what the building is going to be in the end. And I think that model for this project was that point. You'll see some of the light falling on the model later on again.
Then living in a regional area, and in our case, we're very close to an urban area in Wollongong and Sydney, but we do still live in a very small town, if you will. And you know, you get to know everyone, and this become something we've really learned, is how important it is to engage with the community you live in, for various reasons. For our benefit, because we get to learn so much, we get to understand the place, and we get to understand the people better. But also because traditionally it isn't an area that architects always have worked in, particularly in residential architecture. There's no architecture department at university. It's a big university, but there's no design department, so there just isn't that many architects around, full stop. And so we found it really important to talk to people, tell them about what we do, how we work, and how we can assist the smallest project, really, and try to make this a better environment for all. And that's been just really lovely. So there's regular gatherings, usually around the fireplace, of various creatives who all share ideas and who work with each other often. So from that, a lot of collaborations have spawned with furniture designers, graphic designers, and other people who we all love our little shared projects. We have a public talk series that we've been too busy to run for the last 6 months, but we try. And we've got regular gatherings of architects and designers, calling the beer coasters because it's often at a pub, but sometimes it's on our deck where we have a little slideshow, or we just chat about any questions anyone might have, or the newest development approvals that one of the councils waved through and they're horrible, anything like that. And we love engaging with that sort of community, and it's really only possible because of the small area. I think it wouldn't happen in the same way as in Sydney. Off to the next phase, less glamorous now, development applications, approvals. I think not glamorous, but really important actually, because it's just a step further from engaging with the community around you. It's engaging with the wider community that council represents, really. At that point also, many other people come into play, start to work together with other consultants, and build relationships with people who will later contribute to the success or failure of a project. So it's still really important. We also try to start talking to a builder at this point, and so that we can set off on a path where we all have a shared experience and a shared aim for a project to complete it consistently. That's not always a straightforward process. Sometimes, in the case of that escarpment house, it results, you have to keep working on this. So there were, I think, three or four Section 96 changed to the DA applications. So we try to be flexible throughout the process. We never stop sketching. So in this case, for example, there's one where we walked inside and there was this window plan in the middle there. And we realized that from our point of view, from a connecting bridge back, we couldn't actually see the edge of the escarpment, causing a total fail. So we had to go back to council, ask them to amend the window so that we could actually capture the view as it was planned. Because in a computer model, it seemed to work nicely, but it doesn't always happen on site. This is Kambiara, so there then other things come into play. This is an off-grid house, so there was many consultants to be talked to deal with stormwater, sewage and those things. Solar, so we ended up drawing a whole solar array on the roof, which then moved into the back paddock. So it's actually quite interesting, and it really sets you on the right path or not, because otherwise you can get stuck with something that hasn't been thought through but been approved, which you later might not want to build. We also get involved in the costing of every building quite intensively, or increasingly so, because we found that really that's usually the one point of contention within a project. That's what can make a project fall or not. Having a clear idea of the costing and talking to the client early on and consistently at every stage about it is just really important, even though it's a little bit tedious. But we get better at it as we go. And building things ourselves helps us, obviously, to do that more accurately, which then eventually leads to projects being more successful. So there's all those things, stormwater management, big wastewater reports, they all get collated, but it's really collecting people along the way who can help you get it built. That went through really smoothly, unlike the Blade House. Sometimes you get this, an objection. That's only a fraction of the letter we got. You have to then read it, try to understand it, and respond to it, which is made quite hard by the fact that most of it is redacted, so we didn't even know what the issues were. I mean, we did know because the neighbour had enjoyed an unimpeded view across the site boundary over an empty site for 20 years, so anything we did was always going to be a problem because it was a single-storey cottage next door. So there was, in the end, this is of course not a pleasant process necessarily, but it all comes down to negotiation. And because we live around the corner and we are part of the community, those things have to be handled really carefully. And in the end, it allowed us to make some changes. We made amendments, we made the building a whole lot shorter, made it a bit wider secretly as well as we went, because once the plans are submitted and stamped, they didn't notice that bit. allowed them a little bit more view through. They had to have a view from the front anyway, and we got it through the end, but it was a long process. So we get really tired, of course, after that.
Need a break
sometimes. Frank goes surfing. We spend a lot of time at the beach, which is why we love living there.
That's someone walking their horse on the beach.
Yeah, that was pretty funny. And we're not just business partners, we also live together. And we've got a son, so we do take time out to experience, but then experience nature in ways that helps us understand our buildings better, I think. So off we go to construction documentation. And I know that a lot of students sometimes are a bit daunted by this, but we love it. That's where the fun starts, because that's where we get to put our ideas into an actual buildable building. And some of it's more interesting than other things, so there's slab plans to be done and things like that. But it really, it comes back to this question of detail and its importance in the architectural process of how, when you come up with a great concept design, that's all very well, but if you can't carry that through to every detail, the building won't feel as architecturally immersive and of high quality as it could be. So we think this is critical, really, to carry that through as far as you can take it. Which we do. There's bathrooms, detailed sections, details. We do framing plans if need be for builders, if that's critical to what we're trying to do and how it lines up. We get involved into interiors sometimes, actually not always. Always the joinery, but not necessarily to this detail, furniture and fabrics. But those clients at the Camp Yarwa, they were really most interested in that. They came to us with a mid-century modern brief. We said to them, look, we're not living in the 60s, so we can't do that, because then you have to do time travelling. So we have to find a modern expression of the qualities that you're after when you look at a mid-century modern house. And so that went a little bit further in the interior design in that case. Again, that shows how much a client can, how much input they can have if you involve them in the design process.
So just, notice the calm kitchen.
Yeah, notice the calm kitchen design, and you'll see later what happened after that. This is the documentation for the Blade House. It was all about the set out. It was tight on the side. The setback was just right, so we just have to get that absolutely right, otherwise the council's away at the end, and council's going to make you pull it down again. So there was a lot of set out drawings of those blades facing, with the glazing facing exactly north. Glazing schedules. We use the 3D model at this point. We mainly use to do our lighting designs. So we try different things. We try to work out how the extremes of lighting in the house might work and what that does for the spaces, and how it helps us reiterate our design ideas.
Yeah,
I'll do it.
It's us.
We've spoken about great mentors before. So this is a page where we just wanted to make sure they're in there, because without them, we couldn't do any of this. We would not have learned what we have, and we couldn't practice how we do without those people. So on the left there is Brent in Byron Bay with Christine Vadas. She was the surfing boss. He always tells the story how we turn up late to work, and the traffic was really bad, sorry, I didn't get up here. She was living up the hill. And then she'd say, really? Is that maybe a snorkeling mask around your face? Because he just had sunburn like this. And, on the top there's David Trevelya. He's our architecture dad, really. we call him every time we have a problem or we just want to talk something through. We call him. He practices in Tasmania and he came to architecture late. So he makes up for that with so much life experience. He sails a yacht, he built a yacht, and he's an all-round lovely person. Below, Poye Adams, a practice I worked for in Sydney 15 years ago. They taught me a lot about attention to detail, persistence, perfectionism, but also a good partnership between two people. She's the wild child, she's very creative, and he held it all together at the end. In the middle there is Andy McDonald, a practice where Brent and I met. We both worked for him for a couple of years, Brent for longer. I think he taught us about being brave and to take on, he had no fear taking on bigger projects. So the project we worked for most of that time was a $9 million house. It also taught us about what we didn't want to do in our practice. It was all great to have so much money at your disposal to do what you wanted to do, but it was also, the house was disposable at the same time. So for that one in particular, there was a bathroom installed, took a long time to document, 3 months to build, was pulled out 5 days later because the black mirror that the client wanted at the end, his mother had run into it and he demolished the whole bathroom. That was it. So we decided that that wasn't the people we wanted to work with necessarily. On the right is Mark. He's a builder who we started out with. We've worked with him on most of our projects really to date, and we've tasked 10 years, and he's taught us many things on site, like allowing us to be part of the construction process and inviting us to try things as we went. And then most importantly, our other teacher, the tools of making things. So I think this is what you need to fix two pieces of timber together, all the pieces. We come to the construction process. This is the escarpment house in Thurl. We just go through, I think, just certain parts of the project that have carried through from the concept design that might be interesting in our involvement in the construction process. So there's this really overriding theme of that concrete structure that runs through the house and the roads into the garden with a concrete pool and a concrete floor. We chose to use black concrete for that because it was all harking back to that experience of the coal seams below the actual building. Because we were pouring concrete anyway, we went, well, what else can we do? So we made the builder make some formwork to do the pavers at the same time, so they would all work together. And our son greatly loved that slab for some reason. This is the concrete portals coming together. The formwork, they were built first, so there was this amazing moment of where the formwork was actually just as beautiful as a completed building. It was all our builder actually built the formwork himself, and it was just perfect. We experimented a lot with timber screens because we were interested in the history of this carbon as a timber cutting area. We made prototypes for all the screens and how they could come together and the spaces within it in our workshop, and they turned out exactly like that, which is just great. It's always important, I think, to make use of the talents of all the people that you meet inside. And one of the carpenters, he was actually a metal worker as well. He had a great forge at home and did a lot of steel work. So as soon as we heard about that, we said, look, we're going to make use of this. So we designed some lights, we'll talk about it in a minute, but also the door handle, which, funny enough, it's become a pattern now, so I don't think we have specified a front door handle in 10 years. I think we all designed them and either made them ourselves or had the builder make them. And you know, there's a funny, nice little friendly smiley face in this one as it turned out. There's the lights that we designed. They're a combination of his carpentry and steelwork skills. They're all black steel. Wollongong is obviously a steelwork area, so we try to make use of the locally available resources and talent as we go. And also, I think we specify product, but only if it's good enough, if it's ideally local, if there's design integrity, and if there's some integrity in where it's come from. If not, then we'd rather design it and make it. So that's him in front of his garage. And so we had to, because we were using black steel, we're really close to the ocean, we needed to protect it somehow. And we came across this old method of dunking it in flaming, heating it up, dunking it in oil afterwards to create a protective barrier around steel but retain the black steel character. There's still rust, but only on the surface, 2 degrees, as you can see up there. He nearly burned his house doing that for us, but turned out really well. We were super pleased because he had it in the wheelbarrow, the oil was in the wheelbarrow, and then had to move it somewhere else because it caught fire, and the wheelbarrow tipped over, and it was all not that great. But he saved, his wife saved the day, I believe. She went for the fire blanket. I think he's done that before. she was nonplussed. So that's the completed project. This is probably the most well documented because it's the oldest one. I think it's really important to document buildings as you go so that you have this record that you can refer back to. So here it really becomes visible on the left is the south side of the house. It's really closed off, protects from the winds. And there was also a two-story residence was supposed to be built as an approval on the side. I won't say anything about it, but it wasn't great and it was very close. So we kept that side really close, and then it opens up to the garden and to the north. And there's the black portals and black concrete floor. The front door is facing west, and the stair sort of sits behind it, which gives this great effect of the western sun as it's setting, coming through the stairs and illuminating the whole house. I love that bit. A few interior things. This one was great because it really, in its very detail, turned out exactly like we drew it, which isn't that common. We make changes usually, but this one, from the beginning to the end, was a fairly direct process, I'd call it. This is the back on the outside, the concrete portal there, eroding into the garden, holding up the little covered area roof. And the marks, the sun makes, the shadows, that's really important to us, and also the timber itself leaching onto the concrete, making marks, which we were pretty shocked to discover, because we loved those. And then the client called up one day and said, "I've cleaned all the concrete, it's awesome." It's like, no, don't do that. That's the back of it, in the entry area. We'll switch to the next project.
So this is the Robertson house on site, and I think I'll just go quickly through these because I think you can get an understanding of the fact that when we're administering the contract of these projects, it does give us an opportunity to be there often, to communicate, to make changes. So here we were setting out the site. After our initial site visit, we did our sketches, we showed the client, we made the model, and then we took the drawings up there with them and pegged it out where we were. They made us adjust it for various reasons, and we kind of were there and able to discuss that with them until we're all happy that that made sense. We get a few surprises along the way. This is a 120,000 litre water tank. We weren't quite ready for the scale of that when we turned up one day. And this, I had this moment where there's not many places in our buildings where we use a gloss finish, that's fair to say. And we turned up on site for one of these site visits, and I just came across the most breathtaking reflection on the floor platform as it was just been raining. And so that allowed us, you know, being involved in that part of the process allowed us to then explore the finishes in that location later on, so that it does have a glossy floor. We do a lot of work with each of the separate trades, the sub trades, so the shop room to go backwards and forwards between us, the work with the stonemason. Pretty much have got
the window system.
Well, okay, so we're we're quite fond of Leverance. He's an architect that spent a lot of his life working in architecture, and then went into window systems. He pretty much invented steel windows as we know them today, but by the end of his life he decided that the best way to frame a window was to glaze it from the outside and leave it as simple as it can be. So you'll often see in our work framed openings, the bottom section in the bottom right, the top right, all of these windows have been clipped on with stainless clips, and it does have the effect of drawing you through the framing into the view, because obviously this house is all about that view. There's not a lot of that. You can see it in the background here. This is the stonemason. We went and met with Pommy Robb and had a chat to him, and he convinced me that the thing I really needed to understand was that he had to charge me extra to cut corners for me. And I said, "You're going to charge us extra to cut corners?" He said, "Yep, because if you want these perfect corners, I've got to cut them." So we paid him extra to do this. But we worked with them to get an estimate to give the client to connect between the rather artistic, you might say, side of the creative people on the site and the clients, who in this case were at the other end. They wanted everything, you know, to be particularly outlined in spreadsheets and things. So we're kind of constantly making that communicative connection between different trades. Again, the front door, this one, the front door handle gets a is the section of the house, which kicks up to the west, but it's actually rotated. And we've continued, we've been for a long time now making towel rails and handrails for various items inside the bathrooms. There's the kitchen. Influence, you know, we did have a lot of conversations with the client about all these things. They chose the tiles, they went through the process, they chose a lot of this stuff, and we, you know, it's their house, so we're very happy to work with them and try and find something that we feel kind of resonates quite with their personalities. We put this in for students. You need to be really good friends with spreadsheets to be an architect. This is our contract administration spreadsheet. This one's got 20 claims. The left-hand side starts with all the trades, then the second part's got the variations that occurred along the way, and every point of those variations through the job. We had to do some inventing, some thinking, some negotiating, some deciding, because they were generally points that we thought, hey, you could do something better here. We always give them the choice whether they want to do it or not, but by having a bit of a handle on this side of things, I think it really makes a difference to being able to influence that end result. Just some finish shots of that one. This is the Blade House, and you saw the construction drawings that Katharina and I were talking about that we made for the house. This house had one set out. It was a grid spacing of 1900 millimetres. It had a triangle. The triangle had an angle. It had a distance on each side. We gave that to the builder, and weeks later, he still couldn't figure out what to do with this triangle. He kept calling us saying, this is what's holding us up, this is what's holding us up. Eventually we turned up on site, and his form workers were all car park form workers from the city, and they had no clue as to what we're trying to do. And we said, look, go and get us some form work, and we just made it with them. That is after the East Coast low that hit us the moment after we cut the ground open and completely collapsed, so there's been negotiating there. The other picture here is the process of pouring that concrete, and I think there's a lot of lessons that we still learn just standing on site, watching what's going on, being there, putting ourselves. This guy's, the guy at the top, he's in every single photo, and I still don't know what he did the whole time. I know we paid him, but I don't know what he did, because he was never doing anything. The second guy's got the switch for the concrete pump, so he's turning that on and off, and you can see him squirting some concrete into the stairs here. The third guy's got the vibrator. It's basically a whippersnipper with a vibrator on the end, and he's making sure the concrete comes down to the bottom. And at the bottom is the carpenter just going, oh my God, this guy's an idiot. And really, so I think the thing here is that you really need to be watching what everybody's doing. It seems, especially this is a really good example, it seems like it's complete chaos. But if you spend some time trying to understand what everybody's role is in this process, you become a much better architect, I think. We knew what we were interested in well, this is a whole other, this is going a whole other lecture. So we used to have this joke at Queensland University with Peter O'Gorman and Britt Anderson, where they would say that, you know, one material had to speak to the other material, and so we'd sit in the back and go, hello. but here we actually are trying to make this timber have a conversation with the rest of the world, because we can't understand why in Australia pine is such a hidden thing. It's quick, it's easy, it's in Scandinavia, it's got a completely different cultural understanding. It's shown, it's respected. Here you don't, buildings look absolutely beautiful, wonderful when they're framed up. Everyone posts them on Instagram, look at the skeleton, and then it's all gone. We kind of wonder whether that's just something to have a discussion about. And so on this occasion, when we didn't have the budget for a hardwood wall, which of course is a traditional method of stacking hardwood so it can dry, we were going to use green hardwood, but we didn't have the budget. So we did, and we gave them setup drawings on the way to make it what we thought was foolproof. They got it right, but there were some other things that went on. But the point is that each of these elements that we're making I think deserve the consideration, and when you're involved in the construction process, you get the chance. Here's Katharina marking out. We just saw an opportunity to knock out a few grout joints and put some glass in to get a little bit of light into the garage. A bit of this concrete bench the client made themselves, and you can see the cold joint through the bench there, which we love. The concreter died because it looked terrible, but we left it there. So there's this ability to, if you're standing there with the client and you're talking to them about the possibilities, then you can show them, hey, you can do this, or they can say, we want to do this, and give them a crack. Again, at some point, the client got it in his head that he's a miner, so this is a miner's cottage. This is what a miner's cottage looked like today. There's not that many miners anymore, and those that are work very hard and get paid reasonably well. And this is... Yeah, he wanted to put some blocks in here, so we ended up having to redo the blockwork set outs. You can start to see the relationship with the escarpment, the stairs. It's kind of finished.
This was yesterday.
This was yesterday. Yeah, it's nearly finished. We'll get there eventually. But yeah, the moments that we really enjoy in that process are when finally some parts of the earlier connection, earlier model making. With the actual building, some interiors.
I think what's interesting about this one is that just going back to how much we enjoy to work with materials and their inherent qualities, we found this particular type of concrete sheeting. Everyone's used to bare stone around now. This really fairly clean concrete looking FC sheeting. We found this cheaper product, and this was a fairly low budget for a three-bedroom family home and the granny flat. So they thought, oh, well, why don't we put that on the inside as well? So there we've got those AC that it's called balls. I probably shouldn't be saying that on video. But
they make them expensive now.
They make them expensive now, probably because people have used them. But it's a very industrial product. But if you combine it with the sort of care that client particularly brings to a home, and they've got many beautiful things, and they're interested in how they age, and fabrics and flowers, you can make things shine for their inherent qualities instead of painting over them and covering them up. And that's why we do it, really.
It's a Friday night. We've got a text, one of those texts where you go, do I really want to look or not? And I did say thank you, which was delightful. So I think in closing, at the end of the day, sharing the design process allows us to share the important, allows us to reach a mutual understanding with our client about the origins, about the about the important things that the bigger picture of design. I shouldn't read. So we think it's important to share it.
With you as well, but also with the client. And then with the public, ideally, if we can. I think we always delight in other architects sharing more than just the end result. When we buy architecture books, first thing I go is there any construction drawings in there, or plans, or things that help me understand how you get there, not just their arrival point, because that's how you take someone with you and make it their journey as well. Thank you.
Thank you.